Every coach wants to deflect credit towards players, and the players, it's not me. But you had to have some personal feelings of your own yesterday, you know, when the clock hit 0-0-0, and you won. What were some of your thoughts about taking this job, about your father, about everything else, when you actually won again?
Well, first off, Jerry, I have to correct you because it really is about the players. Look, our job is to manage the team, but it's their team. So they make the plays, right? Our job is to put them in position to make the plays, and our guys had enough toughness to make plays. So I give them all the credit. It's a players-driven team. This is one of the best players-driven teams that I've been around because they care about themselves. But the thing I will tell you is, you know, when I was at Akron, we were in 7 straight championship games. I think we were in 9 in 13 years, and I was tight for those games because I was young, you know, and I was still chasing the dream a little bit. I can tell you during this 4-game stretch that we had, I was not tight. I was relaxed, maybe because I knew it was, you know, going to come to an end. And I just figured, hey, let's just try to enjoy the moment. And so those guys made the plays when it mattered. And I think, you know, just being relaxed helped our team because they never got into a frenzied situation. And as many of you know, sometimes I'm not the most relaxed in the world. So I think it was good for us. I mean, everybody wants to win. I mean, nobody wants to end as a loser. That's why we do this job. You know, we can sit there and, you know, talk about this, that, and the other, but we get paid to win games, right? And that's, if you don't win games at this level, then you don't have a job. And people are miserable, and everybody says you're a rotten coach. And we all know that. And this is not a job for the weak and the timid, especially in the modern era of the internet and, you know, things like that. So, yeah, it means it's special to be able to go out. But, again, like, I've never won an NCAA tournament game other than in Division II or in high school, you know, if you call that an NCAA tournament game. So, yeah, I want to win a Division I tournament game and a 2 and 3 and 4. And I want to be Florida Atlantic or George Mason or VCU. Like, you know, that's what we're in for. You know, we'll see what happens. We just have to play relaxed and be, you know, just keep throwing rocks. That's what we're going to do.
Keith, how do you attempt to put into words what this program means to you?
Well, look, so I left my hometown where I played, where my kids went to school, where my mother was a professor, where all my friends and family were to come here. So there's your answer.
You said that if your dad was going to wear his letter jacket into his casket, then you had to resurrect Duquesne basketball or die trying. Is it safe to say you've resurrected Duquesne basketball?
Well, look, what I try to do is every program I leave, I try to leave it in a better place. So I'm sure our next coach will take it to the next level.
Keith, speaking of the next coach looking ahead to the future, do you have a say in who's going to replace you?
Dave's the boss.
And I'll just say today's about Keith Dambrot, period. He deserves this. He deserves, in all of what's going on, the team deserves this week. He deserves this week, and that's what today's about.
But he's the boss, but I'm strong-willed. As he knows, he's probably so happy to get rid of this pain in the ass, trust me.
No.
Keith, did you have any resistance from anybody, without mentioning names, any resistance of people trying to talk you out of retirement?
My wife. I mean, she's hit me 15 times, you know.
She's been behind you the whole time.
Yeah, she wants me to stay, but.
Keith, I know when COVID shut down that year, you felt really good about that team. How were you able to do reboot two, and how much of a different challenge was that for you?
I think the biggest challenge for us with this team is just the niche, you know, finding the right niche for our group. That team was a little bit different than this team. It was built a little bit more inside out, which is a little bit more my comfort zone. You know, we had Marcus Weathers, who was one of the best inside out players in the league, who's turned out to be a great pro. We had Mike Hughes inside as well. And then, you know, we had one of the best point guards in the league in Sincere Carey, with Tavian Dunn-Martin and some other really good players. So, like, that was a good team. I think this team's a little more cohesive. In fairness to that team, though, they played every game on the road. So it's a little difficult to judge. You know, I think that team won 6 games on the road just in the conference, which was a good, you know, which is a pretty good measuring point of that you're pretty good. But this team here has won a lot of games on the road and also has won a lot of neutral games. So if you win neutral and road games, you're a good team. And so this team here, once we found the right correct niche, and Rick McFadden, Drew, and all our coaching staff, Terry Wygand, Andy Allison, Steve Wright, and Ari Stern, who's done an unbelievable job individually with our guys, they found the right niches. And probably this is the most I've ever delegated, and it probably is a lesson learned after 500 years of coaching that maybe you ought to do it a little bit more.
Keith, I know this job was called Mission Impossible when you took it. Did it ever feel impossible to you?
More than once. I mean, the hard part about this job is we had to play catch up, which Dave did a really good job and the Board of Trustees and Ken of getting us on at least good footing, you know, as far as financial support, you know, caring about winning. But the hard part about this job is it's an unbelievable landing spot for transfers, and everybody in the league has good players, and it's not a first time coach's job team thing. So you got Fran Dunphy at LaSalle. You might say, oh, well, LaSalle doesn't have great resources, but they got a coach that's won 600 games. And then you got Archie Miller at Rhode Island, and you got Frank Martin, who's been at the Final Four, and Bob McKillop was at Davidson, who's a Hall of Fame coach, and you got Dayton's resources, and you got VCU, who's been in the tournament a million freaking times. You got St. Louis, who's got unbelievable resources. So the hard part about this job is just like playing in the ACC or the Big Ten, relatively speaking, in that, you know, if you go 10-8 in the Big Ten or you go 10-8 in the ACC, generally you get, or the SEC, generally you get in the tournament. And now with the way the dynamics are in the you know, with the NCAA tournament, there's not that many mid-major bids. So it makes it a really hard job. And it won't get any easier. I will tell you that it's very important that people keep putting resources into the program and then believe in your coach over time and make sure that, you know, you stay behind them because, you know, had I not been a little bit older, it could have been really difficult for me.
Keith, I'm curious, what are some of the flashbulb memories of your time here at Duquesne that pop out to you as you've been reflecting, other than obviously this weekend, I'm sure, is up there, but some of the other ones that pop out?
Oh, boy, that's a hard one. I mean, the first time we won 19, and then we won 21, and then you win 20, and then you become pretty competitive in the league, you know, not over the hump, but pretty competitive. I mean, I felt like this year was one of those years that I felt like we could beat almost anybody in the league on any given night. And I think that other team as well, but I think this team was a little bit more defensive grounded, you know, where we were going to be in every single game. It was just a matter of, you know, whether we were going to move the ball enough and shoot enough balls in. Like even last night when I think we went 1-for-19 over one stretch. I mean, that's not very good. But it's funny because I never really even noticed it much because the score didn't change that much until the last couple minutes of that stretch. And that's a tribute to the fact that we're built at the defensive end. And if you're built at the defensive end, then when you don't play very good offense, you can still survive. So that's going to be key for us going into the NCAA tournament. We play one of the best offensive teams in the country, if you look at BYU. And, you know, if we get caught into their game, we're going to have problems. But if we play our game, they may not have seen much of that.
Dave, you mentioned your confidence in Keith and in hiring him. There were obviously some bumps in the road. Keith mentioned the having to play road games for a couple of years. There was the season 2 years ago. What kept you confident that Keith was the right guy?
Well, you're going to be hard-pressed to find a game where he's going to be out-coached. It's just innate. He's very an extremely talented coach. I will tell you this, underappreciated coach here, underappreciated coach nationally, has kind of flew under the radar. But he's a phenomenal basketball coach. And it was just about sticking to our principles. You know, every coach has a season where everything happens to him. You've got to be supportive in those moments and times. And you just got to say, what's the DNA of the individual? And I knew it. And so we took it purposefully. You know, he was so purposeful in recruiting such wonderful young men with, you know, high character, high talent. And you could just see it coming. You know, the last three games of the regular season, you could see it coming. And it came to fruition in four games in 4 days, which is fantastic. And you just have to have belief and be a partner. That's what it's about.
Keith, you're still, you know, a younger guy, according to the way I look at things.
Are you comparing yourself to me?
Yeah, well, I'm older than you, so I can say that.
Your job's less stressful than mine, though, I think, Jerry, right?
Yes, it is. Yes. I'll give you that for sure.
You look better than me, too, by the way. So
you look all right. But I'm just curious, since you do have a lot of years left, do you think you might get back into coaching someday at some level, somewhere?
It depends how much my wife likes me. You know, I don't know. You never say never. I don't see it really. Like, I don't know whether maybe I'll, you know, go to a bunch of practices, or maybe I'll do part-time scouting for an NBA team. I don't know. Like, I really haven't thought much about it. It's been such a whirlwind. That's probably a mistake in some regards. Like I said, I really don't have many hobbies, so it's going to be interesting. But I have a lot of friends in coaching, so if nothing else, I'll just travel around and watch them practice. And then I got a lot of players that are playing professionally, so maybe I've never been to Europe, so maybe I'll go to Europe and watch them play, or maybe I'll go watch Braun play, or one of these other guys, I'm sure some of these guys here are going to be playing professionally. I'll go watch them play, but I told them I'm not going unless I get a free ticket, because I'm not paying for a ticket.
Keith, how do you kind of manage the emotions that I'm sure you're dealing with that we're seeing a little bit, while at the same time knowing the task at hand here and you guys have a massive week ahead?
I'm pretty good at compartmentalizing. You know, this isn't really my thing right here. I really don't like to, you know, I don't really like to be around, you know, have to answer questions when it deals with family and personal things. Which most people can understand. And I am a sensitive human being anyway, so my kids laugh at me because I cry in movies and things like that. So, and then I feel badly when young people, I'll tear up some when young people make mistakes or struggle. But I'm good at compartmentalizing. I've spent my whole life at this job, and it's important to me, so I try not to cheat the job. And that's one reason that I'm gonna retire, is I don't ever want to cheat the job, because I've kind of prided myself on being the first one in the office, you know, working hard, trying to outwork people, because I wasn't blessed with great natural ability, both physically and a little bit better mentally than physically. I got my mom's genes, none of my dad's athletic genes. I'm the worst athlete in my family. So I didn't want to cheat it, and I just felt like, you know, I could see myself losing that edge at some point, and that's why I just said, you know, I don't want to end like that. I'm not built that way.
We'll take two more questions, and then Keith will be available individually. So,
Keith, you mentioned going to watch LeBron. Have you told him the news yet, and what was his reaction if you did?
No, I didn't tell him. I talked to him yesterday, which is a tribute to him. You know, it just shows how much he cares about us. Not maybe not me so much as Drew, but he's been great with me as well. Like, you know, when a superstar like him calls you after a game, that means something, right? And so I'm sure he probably knows, you know, he knows me well enough to kind of have an inkling that this was going to be it for me. But I'm just thankful to have the relationship with him. This is a hard statement. He's a better human being than he is a basketball player, which tells you a lot. He did a lot for our community.
Keith, given your ties to the university, there's going to be a lot written about you, the program in general this week, a lot of attention that you guys haven't received in a long time. Was it important to you to put them in a position not just to tell the story of this team, but to tell this people to maybe realize the history of this program is not what it's been for the last 47 years, but for the 47 years before that?
Well, that's why I came. You know, obviously, I know the history. You know, probably one of the things I'm most proud of is in 1954, Duquesne started in the national championship game 3 African Americans and 2 Jews. I mean, that tells you all you have to know about the university. Think about that statement, 1954. I mean, 3 African American, 2 and 2 Jews at a Catholic institution. So, you know, my dad was always proud of that. And so I think that's why I came, because I knew the history. And I thought it was a perfect situation for me in particular, especially if I wanted to put myself through anguish and challenge myself. You know, I've always been somebody that wanted to challenge myself, and I knew this. It was a little bit harder job for a younger person to take than it was for me. So the worst case scenario is I go 7 years and I get fired, right? And I retire anyway. But for somebody in their 40s, you know, where the last, I don't know, so many coaches were fired, it's a tough take, right? Because, you know, if you get fired, it's hard to rally back and get another job. So hopefully now, you know, people realize that it has capabilities to be a good job. And, you know, I think it'll be a good job from here on in, as long as the people that are here. You never know when things change with new president, new AD. Anything can happen, right? But right now it's in good footing. It's in a good place. It's got good resources. And we just have to keep believing that it can get back to what it used to be. Now, it'll never be, just so we're clear on this, it'll never be like when my dad was here, you know, but it can be right up there as a top 25 program every single year. Now, no pressure. I mean, don't think that's going to happen much, because it's difficult.
Is that your parting gift? Thanks.
Yeah, fire the AD if it doesn't. And the president. No. Anyway, it's college basketball is hard. So, like, you can have all the resources in the world and the best people, and you might have a bad year. You just have to stick with that person. That's my parting gift to everybody. You think the next guy's better, but you may have the best person in place and you don't even know it. Appreciate everybody coming, and let's go get another one. What do you say?